January 2016, NASA releases a new image of a strange structure on the surface of Pluto. It appears to be an enormous ice volcano on what should be a geologically dead planet.
On the flanks of this big summit depression is the caldera of the volcano. Nothing like this has been seen anywhere in the solar system. It's got us baffled.
Now, scientists believe that just beneath this volcano is an entire ocean of water. The mysterious image that triggered this discovery is one of thousands that scientists are still downloading from a historic flyby of Pluto in July 2015.
Stand by for telemetry.
3, 2, 1!
Even today, much of the data from the flyby, between 35 and 40%, is still up on the spacecraft and no human being has seen it. We don't know what discoveries will be in them.
How did a team of explorers become the first people in history to capture images of Pluto's surface? And what can explain mysterious new photographs like Pluto's volcano? A team of young university students and scientists set its sights on the last unexplored planet in the solar system.
You know, if somebody said, well, were you all obsessed with Pluto, I think we would all have to plead guilty.
At the time, Ralph McNutt is a physics professor at MIT.
I think I did always dream of being an explorer. I've been a space cadet since I was a kid. And at that time, Pluto was just this incredible big question mark. All we knew was it was a spot of light in the sky.
But with the dwarf planet 3 billion miles away and smaller than our own moon, even the best telescope images are too small to reveal any detail.
The best image from the Hubble Space Telescope of Pluto is this fuzzy ball that's about 6 square pixels by 6 square pixels. So here are these upstart kids that were saying, we ought to go to Pluto. We ought to finish out the exploration of the solar system. So at some point, the moniker Pluto Underground was born.
Yeah, the Pluto Underground. I like to call them the Pluto Mafia. These are the folks who've, you know, spent almost their entire careers studying Pluto. You know, Pluto was the end game. This was our opportunity to finish the task of the exploration of the solar system.
Young graduate students united by their fascination with the outer solar system, the Pluto Underground, want NASA to make their dream a reality. And one man would lead them there, Dr. Alan Stern.
We weren't going to answer specific questions. We were going to collect data sets with our eyes wide open to see what was there, literally exploring, literally flying into the unknown.
The Pluto Underground form a plan to fly a spacecraft within 8,000 miles of Pluto's surface, almost 30 times closer than the moon is to Earth. As it flies overhead, the probe will turn and snap the first photographs of the planet's mysterious terrain. But the plan faces an uphill battle.
NASA could be doing quicker missions closer to home and trying to mount an inexpensive mission all the way to the edge of the solar system is a fool's folly.
Alan is a very unique person. And, you know, I think this was almost superhuman act of absolutely dogged determination over the years that made this happen.
Dr. Stern is hopeful that the images will solve an ancient mystery. Pluto orbits in a mysterious region of space, densely packed with unusual moons, dwarf planets, and other misfit objects.
The final frontier in the solar system is the Kuiper Belt, this region of leftover objects from the formation of the solar system. And Pluto is the largest of those objects. It's a very important region for understanding the birth of the solar system.
This means that Pluto is a 4.5 billion year old fossil holding clues about how our own planet was formed.
The Kuiper Belt was discovered, and Pluto went from being this lone misfit in the outer solar system to the biggest, the baddest, and the brightest member of that entire population. This was a very rich scientific target. After all, it's a long way away, so you better have an awful good reason.
In 2003, the Pluto Underground convinces NASA, and the New Horizons mission is born.
We had a lot of difficulties associated with getting to Pluto, one of which is it's 3 billion miles away.
We're driving to, 33 times as far from the sun as the Earth is.
The longer a spacecraft travels, the greater chance something could go wrong. So the team wants to reach Pluto within 10 years of launch.
The New Horizons spacecraft was going to be the fastest ever to leave the Earth, more than 30,000 miles per hour taking off.
That's more than 50 times faster than a jetliner.
To cross a 3 billion mile ocean of space required us to travel at this crazy speed. When I was a boy, Apollo missions took 3 days to reach the moon. New Horizons is going to reach the moon in 9 hours. How's that for speed?
To achieve that record-breaking speed, New Horizons must be light. The less weight a launch vehicle has to push against Earth's gravity, the faster it can go. The size of a small piano, New Horizons will weigh just 1,000 pounds, and it can carry only enough fuel for minor course corrections. Once it reaches Pluto, it cannot slow down and enter orbit.
There is no second chance. You're flying by. There's no stopping it. The spacecraft is on a path, a beeline past Pluto. Either you were going to get it or you weren't. And it's terrifying, to tell you the truth.
But if it works, New Horizons will capture thousands of images in incredible close-up detail.
3, 2, 1. We have ignition and liftoff of NASA's New Horizons.
It was a picture-perfect launch. It couldn't have been any better. But still, it was yet another 9.5 years before we finally get to Pluto.
But there's plenty to do while the team waits, including a close pass of another planet.
We needed to pick up some extra energy in order to be able to actually get to Pluto on schedule.
We had this opportunity to fly near Jupiter, steal a little, gravity assist from Jupiter, and increase our speed by 20% and cut 3 years off the travel time to Pluto.
In February 2007, Jupiter's gravity propels New Horizons like a slingshot toward its destination. After nearly 9.5 years of traveling through space, New Horizons is a mere 10 days away from its historic flyby.
I got a frantic call from Alan Stern, the principal investigator, and I could tell that he was breathing hard. He was running down the hallway, and he said, "We've lost communication with the spacecraft."
This had never happened in 9.5 years of flight. How could it be happening today, at the last minute, just on the verge of summiting Mount Everest? Why now? How? What have we done?
We have no spacecraft, no signal, no knowledge of what's going on. It started to sink in that we may be experiencing something that's abnormal on the spacecraft. And I can't tell you how that feels.
Alice Bowman is the MOM, or Mission Operations Manager, for New Horizons.
You allow yourself those 10 seconds of feeling, oh my God, what's going on? And then, your training kicks in.
Alice was in charge of the recovery effort, and there was no way she was going to let this fail after 9.5 years.
Alice scrambles the team to assess the damage, and they make a heart-stopping discovery.
It turns out that we had overworked the main computer on the spacecraft and caused it to reset.
6 months of programming are lost. Now, the engineering team has only a few days to redo everything.
We knew we could fix it. The question was, could we fix it in time for the flyby sequence that was supposed to start on July 7th?
Over the course of 3 sleepless days, the team uploads command codes to New Horizons, nearly 3 billion miles across the solar system.
We're able to get that sequence or set of instructions loaded to the main computer. And we had 4 hours to spare.
If you've got high blood pressure to begin with, this is probably a business you ought to stay out of.
7 days later, the morning of the Pluto flyby has come.
Hang on to your seats because the roller coaster ride is on.
As media from across the world gathers at Johns Hopkins University outside Baltimore, Maryland, all eyes are on Dr. Alan Stern.
We passed inside the orbit of Hydra, the outermost moon of Pluto.
And he's brought an early surprise for the New Horizons team.
The night before closest approach, we made a point of sending home a handful of images in spectra. They were the highest resolution images that had ever been obtained. Pluto went from being just a small image in the distance, sort of like a jeweled Christmas ornament, to all of a sudden, this massive world with unparalleled complexity.
But this is not the image of Pluto the team came to see. It's New Horizons' closest approach that will truly reveal Pluto's secrets. In less than an hour, New Horizons will come within 8,000 miles of Pluto.
If the timing had been off, that we had somehow just messed up, and instead of flying by Pluto at the prescribed time, it was, you know, 1,000 seconds earlier or later, we would have had everything pointed in the wrong place.
You don't want to wait 2 decades and see a bunch of stars.
Okay, we have 25 seconds, folks. T-minus 25 seconds.
At 7:49 a.m., the team counts down to the actual second New Horizons makes its closest approach to Pluto.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Decades of work, they don't come down to one day. They come down to 1 minute, to 1 second.
But no one really knows if the probe survived the flyby until it sends a confirmation signal back to mission control.
Radio signals traveling at light speed are expected to arrive at the APL Mission Operations Center, and we'll go live in the Mission Operations Center so you can watch some of that activity.
At 9 p.m., the team gathers to learn New Horizons' fate.
We are searching for a frequency. Stand by.
Waiting for the spacecraft to report back, you could probably have cut the tension with a knife. Everything's riding on this, and it's an incredibly high-stakes poker game.
Okay, we're in lock with carrier. Stand by for telemetry.
You really don't know if your spacecraft survived, despite all the work that you've done.
Stand by.
Yes.
Okay, copy that. We're in lock with telemetry with the spacecraft. Healthy spacecraft. We've recorded data of the Pluto system, and we're outbound for Pluto.
Okay,
When we got that signal, it was like a celebration for the 10, 15 years of work that we'd put into that mission.
USA! We did it!
This has been beyond my wildest expectations in every regard. I'm ecstatic. It's returning beautiful data, and the Pluto system is just mind-blowing.
Within hours, New Horizons begins to deliver its first images.
Our jaws were just dropping. It was incredible. We had transformed this little pixelated blob into this real world.
What the team sees in the images,
wow,
is completely unexpected.
Even though logically I knew that it was a rocky, icy planet, I didn't expect it to look so similar to features that we have on Earth.
I love this picture. It's one that was made about 15 minutes after closest approach. With the very rugged terrains, many of these mountains are 10,000 feet tall.
The team has discovered mountains of water ice the size of the Rockies on a planet smaller than our own moon.
You felt like you're there, seeing the giant ice mountains and giant chasms, you know, much bigger than the Grand Canyon in the United States. We can actually see glacier flows. It's molecular nitrogen ice. It's almost like water ice is on the Earth, and so it can flow.
The discovery of water ice mountains and nitrogen glaciers leads Alan to one shocking conclusion.
Pluto is geologically alive after 4.5 billion years, which upended many geophysical theories that did predict that small planets would cool off and die early in their history and just be a frozen relic of that time. That tells us that our ideas of how planetary engines work were wrong, and that we had to rethink them.
But one recently downloaded image further fuels Pluto's mystery.
This is one of the most amazing finds we made at Pluto. It's a giant ice volcano that was apparently active late in the history of the solar system. There are almost no craters on the flanks of this structure. The big summit depression is the caldera of the volcano. Nothing like this has been seen anywhere in the solar system from Mars all the way to Pluto. Sometimes I pinch myself that this is a real place that we actually went and visited. It looks like something out of science fiction. And why Pluto should have these features has got us baffled.
An active volcano would mean a source of heat somewhere on the planet. And now, the New Horizons team believes that heat could be warming an ocean of water beneath the surface of Pluto. It is a stunning discovery.
You have, you know, all of these other exotic things going on. What looks almost like tectonic activity. And, you know, where is that coming from?
Why is Pluto still alive? New images might solve the mystery.
The blue sky image, this is something that was absolutely totally unexpected.
The discovery of active geology on Pluto has defied expectations of a frozen, dead world.
There were mountains of pure ice that were 10,000 feet high. There were active glaciers of nitrogen and methane ice. Nobody was expecting the drama and the beauty that we found.
But Pluto's biggest mystery may lie above the surface.
After we fly by Pluto and look back towards the sun, and we can actually see the atmosphere, and see this blue. Pluto has blue skies. Who would have thought? It's just amazing.
This blue atmosphere of nitrogen should have dissipated into space billions of years ago. Something is replenishing it. But what? Could volcanic activity spew fresh nitrogen from deep beneath the surface? New images might soon solve the mystery.
We've got over a year's worth of data to still get down. There's a lot of people that are losing a lot of sleep these days trying to do this as fast as possible. But by far the best images are still to come.